about the farmer, they could look around and see farmers there. So the things that he talked about really happened. They weren't just things that he made up. They weren't his stories. They weren't movie plots. These were things that really happened. Things that really happened. So think about the people who were there, who experienced this. And I want you to put yourself in their place and think about the events from their perspective. It's a little bit of a challenge to us. And we can be a little bit judgmental. I know I can, maybe you don't, but I can look at people and be judgmental. You should know better. You should do better. You should think twice. Why don't you do this? But if we put ourselves there, maybe, and often, I think if I was there in the story, who would Mark, who would I be? Who would I be? Who would Mark be in this story? And honestly, I'm afraid I'd be a Pharisee. Often I think about myself in the story of Jesus. Pharisees were very judgmental. They didn't accept anyone who was different. I would really see myself probably as a Pharisee. So I challenge myself. And today is a challenge when I look at this story. Give a little bit of mercy and grace to this character. But anyway, let's start today with this picture. What is this? This man in blue. Here you have all this crowd. Jesus was arrested with who are these, the disciples. Jesus has been arrested here. You don't see him. Instead, you see the disciples running away. Okay, there's a lot of people coming in this, so that's good. You're enthusiastic, you're interested. Why did the disciples run away? We'll talk about this. So, this is our theme. The last time they saw him. So we know what happened, but again, I want you to put yourself in that moment. And Jesus died. Now, he was in the tomb for 3 days, right? As a person who I'm thinking about the last time I saw Jesus, I think about people who died. We see people who died, and we think about the last time we saw them. And so I wish I could have said this. Or sometimes it's okay. The last time I saw them, we had such a wonderful conversation, we talked together, and Rodney texted me last week, his brother, or his father's brother, who recently passed away. His father's brother. The last thing that he said was, "Thank you for coming." And then an hour later, he passed away. That's sweet, but as a disciple, what would I do before Jesus died? What would be the last time that I saw him? So let's talk about this. The first person we will talk about, any guess? Jesus. No. Chosen, that he was one of the first who was one of the first chosen. His name means rock. So his name means rock. Andrew, Peter's brother. James and John, sons of Zebedee. The four fishermen, or partners. Also known as the sons of thunder. Philip. And we don't know a whole lot about Philip. Bartholomew, we call Daniel, and he would be John. Thomas is also known as Didymus. And Matthew, also known as Levi. And James the Lesser. Now some people think that means he was less important, but most people think it means younger or shorter. Son of Alphaeus. Thaddeus, also known as Lebaeus. Also known as Judas, son or brother of James. There are lots of names here for one person. I know, but... Simon the Canaanite, also known as Simon the Zealot. And then we have maybe the most infamous, Judas Iscariot. So, the 12 apostles are named here. So we are talking about Thomas, also known as Didymus. Now, this name Didymus, what does this mean? The name Didymus. Nickname. It was called Didymus in its Greek. And Thomas is Hebrew. And both of them mean the same thing. Thomas means twin. And Didymus means double or also twin. So we don't know whose twin Thomas was. We don't know who his twin was or why he was called Didymus. We don't know that. But some people think or suspect or guess the reason he was called that is because he looked like someone else. So maybe someone famous. Some people thought he looked like Jesus. And some people thought they called him double because he looked so much like Jesus. Put Jesus and Thomas together and you would realize they look like twins. That's just speculation. We can't say that for sure, but the guess is, and some other people think that he looked like a famous person, like the king, the emperor, or something. But nobody really knows why they called him Didymus. I don't know why, but it's recorded in the Bible, so it's there for a reason. But we don't know exactly what reason, but it's interesting that that was his name. And what did he do what was his work? We don't know. We don't know his background. We don't know what he did, what his responsibility was, where he was from, which city he was born in, who his parents were. We don't know anything. He probably was a twin, or he looked like someone else. So his name, so that he was called Thomas. Some people think he was the younger brother of Jesus. I can't say that for sure. But some people believe that. Anyway, we have Thomas. So what is the point? We don't know much about it. What's the point? From Matthew all the way to Luke, we don't hear anything about Thomas. We just see his name listed in the list of disciples. That's all we see. There's no mention of him. But when we get to Thomas, when we get to John, we learn something about Thomas. It's not what you're thinking. Later on, that appears in the book of John. Before that, how many of you remember, it's funny, we just talked about this in Sunday school, how many of you remember the story of Lazarus? What happened to Lazarus? He was raised back to life. So, this man named Lazarus was sick. Lazarus of Bethany. Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. So, and he was pretty wealthy. He had a house in Bethany that Jesus went to quite frequently. He was good friends with them. In fact, Jesus cared very much for the three of them. So when he heard that he was sick, his sister sent it to him, saying, "Lord, behold, he who now loveth is sick." When Jesus heard that, he said, "The sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified thereby." Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So he says this very clearly, that Jesus loved them. And the disciples said, in verse 5, his disciples, he was thinking about, he said, "Do you really want to go there again?" And Jesus was traveling around Israel. But where was the focus of most of the hatred of Jesus? It was in Jerusalem. So Jerusalem and Bethany are right beside each other. Jerusalem is on a hill, and then there's, and down the hill is the brook Kidron, and then up from the brook on the other side is the Garden of Gethsemane, and then all over that same hill is Bethany. So from Jerusalem to Bethany is just a very short distance. And when Jesus went to Jerusalem, very often he would go to Bethany and stay there with his friends. So Lazarus was sick. Well, I thought we were talking about Thomas. Why are you going on about Lazarus? Now, talking to his disciples, he said, "Our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may awake him out of sleep." So the disciples were happy to hear that Lazarus was sleeping. He said, "Lord, if he sleepeth, he shall do well." Right? That means he's doing well. When you're sick, what do you usually do? You sleep a lot. I thought, oh, sleeping must mean he's doing okay. He's getting better. He'll be better soon. But Jesus was talking about his death. But they thought he had spoken of taking rest and sleep. So Jesus said, "I'm going to go." The disciples said, "Do you want to go there? Why should he not go?" Because of Jerusalem. They were afraid that if Jesus went near there, he would be killed. So they were worried. And again, we see Thomas speaking. Now first, I forgot. Jesus said, "Lazarus is sleeping." And they said, "Oh, that's good, he's sleeping." And then Jesus said, "No, Lazarus is dead." He told him straight out. He didn't understand what he was saying. He said, "Lazarus is dead. And I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there, to the intent that ye may believe. Nevertheless, let us go unto him." Now, Jesus was with the disciples. First they said, "Lazarus is not going to die." And he said, "Lazarus is sleeping." And he said, "Yes, but he's asleep." "No, he's..." And then Jesus said, "No, he's dead." And they said, "What? I thought you said he's not going to die. Now he's dead." This was strange to them. Jesus said, "Now we're going to go and see him." And the disciples warned him, "If you go, they're going to kill you." And Thomas said, I love this, Thomas, which is called Didymus, said unto his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." Thomas believed that. He said, "If Jesus goes there, he's going to die. Let's go die with him. So come on, let's go." But I thought Thomas was the doubter. He was willing to go with Jesus, even to death. And he encouraged the other disciples to go. "He's going to die, you might as well go die with him." Thomas that caused him to be ready to die with Jesus. And again, this was several weeks before he was arrested and crucified. crucified. So Thomas says, let's go. And then as they had the Lord's Supper, as we already had, they had the Last Supper, and Thomas was there. So there's a little bit of a timeline. We know the story that Jesus ate with the disciples, and then what did he do? He went to pray. Where did he go to pray? In the Garden of Gethsemane. And where was that? It was outside the city on the way to Bethany. So, when the disciples, after they ate in the city of Jerusalem, after that, what did they do? They had to walk. They had cars. They had airplanes. They didn't have a subway. They had to walk. And while they walked, Jesus was talking to them. So after they ate and they sang, the Bible says they sang a hymn. And then they went down the hill. And on the way, Jesus was talking to them. And he talked a lot. You read John chapter 13, 14, 15. All the way through 17 is what Jesus said to his disciples. You know, almost four whole chapters of red ink was his conversation with them as they were walking on the way to the Garden of Gethsemane. Shepherd, and the sheep shall be scattered. But after that I am risen, I will go before you into Galilee. Now here Jesus says plainly, tells them, after I'm risen, what are they thinking? They're thinking the next morning when he gets up. I don't know. But anyway, Jesus is telling them this. All of you will abandon me, because if you smite the shepherd, the sheep will be scattered. But after that, so he's saying this, he's telling them they're going to abandon him. But then they keep going, and he keeps talking. In John, John, is John chapter 14. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. Now, hold on a minute. I go to prepare a place for you. Now, some people hear that and say, Jesus is in heaven right now building mansions for us. That's what that means. And he's wondering, prepare a place for you. That's not what that verse means at all. In heaven, I have to prepare that for you. I have to die. Not a verse about Jesus building mansions in heaven. He's not building houses in heaven for us. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. Receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. He said, I'm going to die. He didn't say that. He didn't tell them, I'm going to die. He said, I'm going to make a place for you. And when I'm done, I'll come back and I'll take you to myself and take you with me. So you can go be there with me. You know where I'm going. And you know the way I'm going. The same way Thomas did. You know where I'm going. You know how I'm going. And he raised his hand and said, I'm lost. Thomas was brave, right? He was willing to say, wait a minute. Excuse me, Jesus. So Jesus is making a messianic claim here. Jesus is saying, I am God. You see me, you see God. You've seen the Father. He called himself the Father. Tell your Jehovah's Witnesses friends this. If you've seen me, you have seen the Father.
Right there.
So Jesus says this to Thomas. And again, think about this with me. Walking together, and Jesus is talking about where he's going. And Thomas said, well, where are you going? Remember, Thomas was willing to die with Jesus. He said, where are you going? He said, I am the way. And Thomas is with Jesus. And then this is. Thomas. topic. We're not gonna talk about the good news yet. That's coming.
Right.
On Resurrection Sunday, we'll talk about the good news. But for now, think about this. The negative part, okay? Yes, there's negatives. That's the point of talking about Thomas. There's nothing positive about it. For how many hours did he think about it? His whole world being destroyed. His rabbi, his teacher, his friend was gone. He's saying, I should have been there. I should have been with them. And what did he do? What if today was the last day? You have no idea. Your life is going to end. Now again, we're lucky. We saw what happened, the rest of the story. We know what happened. But we don't know the end of your story. Maybe to Thomas. He didn't know what was going to happen. You see Jesus face to face, what are you going to say? I encourage you to keep your faith. Have faith. Don't abandon Jesus. Don't abandon the people of faith as well. I have seen it happen. Well, Christians are hypocrites. Death Liberty Baptist Church, house full of hypocrites. All of us, no exceptions, we are sinners. We should call it Death Liberty. Sick people, not for healthy people. It's not for people who are healthy. It's for people who need God and depend on Him, even during hard times. And if Thomas ran away, I'm sure he was. Even when I feel like I can't. go so that we can die with him. He was loyal. But still, when the time came, he wanted to know more about where Jesus was going, what was going to happen. He wanted to know more about the truth. May we be more like Thomas, desiring and loyal to know the truth, and loyal and ready to go instead of being hesitant. Bless us.